Yeah, 2021 sucked. But there was one good thing to come out of it. It gave me a lot of time to watch a ton of movies, ranging from cult classics to underrated gems to pieces of garbage. In this video, I'm going to rank every single one of the films I saw last year. If you're wondering, there was 110 films. Before you ask, this is based off of George Sheard's. I don't actually know how to pronounce his last name. It's based off of his video, but I still tried to keep this video unique to my style of editing. But make sure to go and watch George's video because it is great. But watch it after this one. Before we begin, I need to clarify some things. Firstly, this list will only include feature films that were either theatrical or streaming service release, so things like most of the Thomas specials won't count. Next, each film will be given a quick reason for its placement, due to the fact that there's so many films on this list. However, there are many films on this list which I plan to do full videos for, so make sure you keep an eye out for them. Finally, this list will be completely spoiler-free in order to allow people to watch any film on this list that they may be interested in without me spoiling it. Anyway, enough chit-chat, on to the video. Number 110, Disaster Movie. The worst movie I have ever seen in my life. Boring, confusing, offensive, and painfully unfunny. I kind of want to do a full video ranting about it, but I honestly feel gross just thinking about it. 0 out of 10. Number 109, Planes. Why I liked this film as a kid, I will never know. This is nothing more than an advertisement for toys to capitalize off of the merchandising success of Cars. An incredibly boring protagonist, but some semi-decent side characters like Skipper. Although, El Chupacabra feels very stereotypical, and why was John Cleese in this movie? 3 out of 10. Number 108, Planes, Fire and Rescue. Basically every problem I had with the first film. The only difference is that I stand Marrow, so that bumps this up. Also a 3 out of 10. Number 107, LA Story. Easily the worst Steve Martin movie. It's just really boring throughout, although there are some great jokes like the earthquake one. Another issue I have is that I'm just not a big fan of romances, so didn't care much for this. 4 out of 10. Number 106, Iron Man 2. Easily the worst MCU movie. It's really boring, and Tony is made really unlikable here. The villains are also really dull. At least Rhodey is great. 4 out of 10. Number 105, The Maltese Falcon. I know I'm gonna get a lot of hate for this, but I found the plot of this film really confusing and hard to follow, so I just could not get into it, so ended up tuning out a lot. Humphrey Bogart is great though, and I would definitely rewatch it at some point after I've seen other detective noir films, just so I can try and get used to the genre. 5 out of 10. Number 104, The Fog. Quite confusing to be honest. I think the film spent too much time establishing the location instead of the threat, as I had no idea who the fog men were. It was explained where they came from, but that was in a random bit of dialogue and some kind of flashback would have helped. Still, music was great and the fog effects were fantastic. 5 out of 10. Number 103, There's Something About Mary. This is a film which peaked in the first 10 minutes. The rest of the film is just okay, if not a tad boring, but like I said, I'm not a big fan of romances, so this film just wasn't for me. But the first 10 minutes bumped it up because it's amazing. 6 out of 10. Number 102, Thor the Dark World. I feel like this film gets a really bad rap. Compared to other MCU movies, it isn't great, but I still had some fun with it. I liked a lot of the ideas, and you can't go wrong with Loki, but Christopher Eccleston was wasted and the Dark Elves are just really crap villains. I still enjoyed it though, but probably won't watch again. 6 out of 10. Number 101, Bridget Jones's Diary. Once again, not a fan of romances. This film did have some funny moments though, and Mark and Dan's fight was amazing, but aside from that, it was very much not for me. 6 out of 10. Number 100, Napoleon Dynamite. I was really hoping I would like this more, as it is such a cult classic for many people, and I constantly see it referenced. It's decent, but it isn't amazing or even great. Kind of dull in places with the odd funny moment here and there. 6 out of 10. Number 99, Pet Sematary, the 2019 one. I just want to clarify that I have never watched the original 80s film or read the book. I will do eventually though. So that's why I liked it more than most people. I thought it had some great creepy moments, but it did leave me very confused, and it apparently isn't a great adaptation, so points off for that. 6 out of 10. Number 98, Monsters vs. Aliens. I rewatched this film after seeing the memes with the general and the president, and the film did not disappoint with them too. That being said, the rest of the film is just okay. It's a decent film for the kids and that's about it. Not as bad as some people say. 6 out of 10. Number 97, Thomas and the Magic Railroad, my ultimate guilty pleasure film. Yes, the plot is overly complex for a Thomas movie. Peter Fonda is trying way too hard at his acting. Thomas isn't even the main character, Alec Baldwin is, and there's now magic in this once fairly realistic show. However, I don't care as it's just funny to me. Also, this was Brett Alcross' passion project, so I'll feel bad to diss it. 6 out of 10. By the way, this is the only Thomas movie on the list, as the other ones weren't theatrical releases. Number 96, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, the definition of a mixed bag. On the one hand, it isn't as bad as people say, and Andrew Garfield is fantastic, and there's some great action and emotional moments. But on the other hand, the villains are horrendous, and some of the silly moments mess with the tone a lot. 6 out of 10. Number 95, Pink Floyd The Wall. This is the definition of a film which isn't for me. The animation and music is fantastic. However, I am not a fan of really trippy things like this film. I also usually think about the plot when it comes to films. So films like this where the plot is kind of irrelevant in favor of more psychological moments, yeah, I'm just not going to be a big fan of it. Overall, it's a great movie that I didn't like. 6 out of 10. Number 94, First Man. The ending to this film is absolutely incredible, and so is the failed Apollo launch scene. The rest of the film is just decent in my opinion. I feel like the story's a bit too slow, and the pacing in general could have been a bit tighter. Still worth a watch for the ending alone. 6 out of 10. Number 93, The Incredible Hulk. Way too overhated in my eyes. I think it's really interesting to see Banner have to go into hiding from Ross whilst controlling his anger. I think the part where he reunites with his girlfriend was quite nice. Although, not seeing Mark Ruffalo does throw me off, and it is one of the weakest MCU movies. 7 out of 10. Number 92, Hotel Transylvania. Nowhere near as good as I remember. I think the kids would still love this film, but teens and adults probably won't. I love the concept, but some emotional moments feel a bit messy, and it is covered with that typical Sony humour, as I like to call it. Still has some funny moments though, and it is really creative. 7 out of 10. Number 91, Cars 2. I have nostalgic bias towards this, as I loved it as a kid. But despite that, I still find this really overhated. As a sequel, it's terrible, and Mater as the protagonist is bad, but the spy story is really gripping for me. The music is incredible, and you can't go wrong with Michael Caine. It's got flaws, but I still like it. 7 out of 10. Number 90, The Jerk. I really like this film. Aside from a few poorly aged moments, it's just a fun time. There isn't much to it, but it's a nice bit of fun and a way better Steve Martin film than LA Story. Number 89, Diary of a Wimpy Kid. I really wanted to watch the whole trilogy, but I could only find the first one. Oh well, it's still a decent movie. I can relate to Rowley a lot, despite not doing middle school because, well, I'm British. I don't relate to Greg though because he's a dick, and that's why I love him for it. The film is just fun, but I do prefer Roderick Rules. 7 out of 10. Number 88, Jingle All The Way. The first Christmas movie on the list. It's dumb and silly, but I find it a ton of fun and quite funny in places. It truly represents the spirit of Christmas, and by that I mean commercialization and stress. However, why was Arnie and Sinbad in this movie? Anyway, 8 out of 10. Number 87, Despicable Me. Very good movie ruined by Facebook. 8 out of 10. Number 86, Despicable Me 2. Slightly better and more funny, but still ruined by Facebook. 8 out of 10. Number 85, Casablanca. I actually watched this film twice this year. First time, I didn't really like it. Second time, I really liked it. So many memorable quotes, and I would call it the quintessential romance film. I recommend everyone watches it at least once. That being said, I still don't like romances. This is much better than most, but still not for me. 8 out of 10. Number 84, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. The first foreign language film I watched properly. It was great, and it was really interesting to see how different the action was in the East compared to the West. However, I will admit that the lack of gravity threw me off at first, but I eventually got used to it. Main issue is that it's a bit slow in the middle. 8 out of 10. Number 83, The African Queen. Rose is one of the best female characters in film, and this is the 1960s! Anyway, this film is really fun, as it's basically just our two leads bickering, and it's a ton of fun. Not much else, it's just really fun. 8 out of 10. Number 82, Black Panther. Black Panther is simultaneously underrated and overrated. It's overrated because it shouldn't be praised solely for the race of the cast. However, it's underrated because I don't think people appreciate the story enough. Killmonger is an absolutely brilliant villain and one of the best in the MCU. And I love T'Challa. Rest in peace, Chadwick. The flaws are a few bits of dodgy CGI, Martin Freeman, who was one of my favourite actors, and his bad American accent, and the length. It was definitely a bit too long. 8 out of 10. Number 81, Thor. This one is really fun and really underrated. I prefer the later personality for Thor, but he's still great in this one. And Hemsworth is totally not one of my many man crushes. Loki is also great as usual. My main problem is that the stuff before Thor was sent to Earth isn't really that interesting. 8 out of 10. Number 80, Captain Marvel. Slightly better than Thor, but not by much. The stories are very similar, but I find Captain Marvel's backstory slightly more interesting than Thor's. However, on the contrary, I don't feel any stakes when Carol is fighting people because she's just too OP. I still think this film's very overhated though. 8 out of 10. Number 79, Scrooged. One of the best versions of A Christmas Carol because it's fun and not boring. Bill Murray is really charismatic as Frank, and I love the ending speech. The main problem with this film is that I didn't like how Frank was spat back out into the real world between ghosts. I wish it stayed consistent. Other than that, it's a ton of fun. 8 out of 10. Number 78, Iron Man 3. Easily one of the most underrated MCU movies. Really, really enjoyable. I love how the events of the first Avengers movie lead into this one. I love how it shows that Tony is suffering from anxiety attacks because of it. It makes him a lot more relatable and human. Rhodey is also still great. However, the film's not really spectacular, so it's going to remain here. 8 out of 10. Number 77, Cars. Easily the weakest of the 2000s Pixar movies, but I feel bad saying that as this movie is honestly great. However, great just isn't enough when compared to the masterpieces of the 2000s Pixar movies. This is definitely no Incredibles or Ratatouille which came around it, but it's still a really underrated fun time with a great message about taking life slowly. The only problems are that I don't like Mater, and the concept of living cars has always been weird to me. If this film came out in the 2010s amongst all other mediocre Pixar films, it'll be appreciated a lot more. 8 out of 10. Number 76, Nativity. It's silly and I can see why people don't like it, but I just find it really fun. Maybe it's nostalgia talking, but I still find the film a ton of harmless fun. Mr. Poppy can get a tad irritating at some points though, but I don't care as this was the first film I saw from Martin Freeman, who is one of my favourite actors. 8 out of 10. Number 75, Wayne's World. The amazing Bohemian Rhapsody scene was sent to Freddie Mercury before he passed away, and he absolutely loved it. Think that says a lot. Also, the sponsor scene was fantastic. Great, fun movie. 8 out of 10. Number 74, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Overhated, I would say, although the villains are crap. The concept for Ghost is cool, but I find her really annoying. And the ending is an anti-climax, but I just find the film a ton of fun. Also, I stan Luis. 8 out of 10. Number 73, Ant-Man. Slightly better. The final battle is amazing, and I still stan Luis. But it wasn't as good as I remember. Simply enjoyable, and that's it. I would kill for Edgar Wright's version, though. 8 out of 10. Number 72, Spider-Man 3. This movie is a masterpiece. Okay, maybe not a masterpiece as it is flawed, but it was the most fun I had watching a film this year. 8 out of 10. Number 71, Interview with a Vampire. A very cool and quite a creepy vampire film. I like quite a lot of the ideas, and it is definitely a good film. It's just not too memorable, especially when compared to the Dracula movies. But it's still better than all of Twilight. 8 out of 10. Number 70, Taken. Kind of reminds me of those really over-the-top 80s action films, and it has the same problem. I can't really relate to our lead, and the scenarios are a bit hard to believe and take seriously. That being said, it's always a fun watch. Liam Neeson is brilliant in this film, and the phone call is iconic for a reason. 8 out of 10. Number 69. Nice. The Boat That Rocked. A nice, fun film which taught me a good amount about pirate radio. Great cast, and it's just as fun as I said. 8 out of 10. Number 68. Monster House. A bit cheesy in a few places, especially with Chowder, but I love him despite that. It's a Halloween classic for me, and I watch it every year. I also think the animation for everything besides the humans looks great. The story is surprisingly dark. A nice fun film for the family. 8 out of 10. Number 67, Frankenstein, the original. the oldest film on this list, and I can see why it was a classic. I adored the beginning and the end of the film, but the middle wasn't too interesting in my opinion. Still, Boris Karloff gives one fantastic and creepy performance as The Monster. 8 out of 10. Number 66, Shrek. Come on, it's Shrek. Do I need to explain myself? 8 out of 10. Number 65, Wreck-It Ralph. The best video game movie despite not being about a specific video game. Very fun and enjoyable, but I do think that too much time was spent in Sugar Rush instead of a few more unique locations. Still, very fun with some great emotional moments. 8 out of 10. Number 64, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Really overhated. I grew up with this film instead of the original, so I always preferred it due to the nostalgia. I do prefer Jeans Willy Wonka to Depths, but aside from that, I generally prefer this film. I'm also a snob when it comes to the original books, so I generally gravitate to the more faithful adaptation. Also, Christopher Lee is amazing. 8 out of 10. Number 63, Bad Santa. I came for the jokes and left with a deep story about a man struggling to find meaning in his life and growing to be a nicer person after someone was nice to him. It still got really funny moments though. 8 out of 10. Number 62, Shrek Forever After. Easily the single most unfairly hated DreamWorks movie ever. Although I am glad to see it gaining a reappraisal thanks to Shay Frillish Productions. Speaking of which, you should watch his video as it's great. Overall, great emotional moments and a perfect end to the Shrek trilogy. Yes, I said trilogy. Number 61, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Some dodgy CGI as well as some hit or miss child acting. Aside from that, a fun movie and a great start to the franchise. I generally prefer the more light-hearted Harry Potter stories to the darker ones, so this story is very appealing to me. 8 out of 10. I was going to watch the other films, but couldn't be arsed, so don't expect them on this list. Number 60, Spider-Man. A lot of fun and a classic for a reason. Willem Dafoe is phenomenal in this. However, sometimes the goofy moments went a bit too far and took away from the seriousness, and I hate MJ in all of the Raimi trilogy. 8 out of 10. Number 59, American Sniper. I heard this film was controversial, but that wasn't because of the film itself, but instead on who it was based on. This placement is based off the film itself and not the inspiration, so... yeah. Anyway, this was a brutal look at the War on Terror. Sometimes I feel like it went a bit overboard, and I never want to watch the film again, but it was still very effective. 8 out of 10. Number 58, Christine. The most underrated Stephen King adaptation as no one ever seems to talk about it. A great John Carpenter score and some really well done and well directed scenes with some creepy moments. A great spoopy movie. 8 out of 10. Number 57, Pirates and an Adventure with Scientists. Really, really fun with some great animation. It has that Aardman charm to it which I can't get enough of. The story is quite simple and the pirate captain, yes that's his name, doesn't really progress as a character, but there are some great action scenes and Mr. Bobo is great. Also Martin Freeman's in it, and so is David Tennant. 8 out of 10. Number 56, The Adventures of Tintin. Honestly, my favourite part of the movie was the opening titles where I found out how many people I knew worked on or was in this film. I mean, Steven Spielberg, Peter Jackson, Edgar Wright, Simon Pegg and Nick Frost, Stephen Moffat!
Forgot about these two.
Anyway, this is a very fun movie with some great motion capture and a really captivating Indiana Jones-esque story with some of the best scene transitions in film. My main problem is that I don't like some of the jokes with Haddock. 8 out of 10. Oh, we're halfway there. Number 55, Doctor Strange. A great movie, but I have to give a massive praise to the visual effects team, as well as the person who provided them with all the LSD. Seriously, there is no way you could do this sober. 8 out of 10. Number 54, Christopher Robin. An incredibly heartwarming film all about growing up and remembering and cherishing your childhood with some phenomenal CGI. Ewan McGregor is surprisingly great in this film, as I didn't think he would fit. I feel like people judge this film as a Winnie the Pooh movie, when it just isn't. It's a Christopher Robin movie. 8 out of 10. Number 53, Zack Snyder's Justice League. Still counts for this list, as I said that films on streaming services counted. Anyway, this is a significant improvement from the original. I am so happy that Cyborg got a proper story this time, and the 4-hour runtime wasn't too bad for the most part. It was a bit slow to get going and the epilogue took forever, and it definitely should have been set up better in the DCEU, but I still really liked it. 8 out of 10. Number 52, Spider-Man Far From Home. The weakest Tom Holland movie simply because the plot with the glasses feels way too convenient. Aside from that, it's fun with some great action. Jake Gyllenhaal is fantastic, and I stan Ned and MCU MJ. I feel like this is loved by some and hated by others, whilst I just find it great. 8 out of 10. Number 51, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. A really, really fun Christmas movie with some great scenes like the sled and lights ones. The finale is also just perfection. But I always feel so bad for Clark. 8 out of 10. Number 50, The Avengers. Back in 2012, this was the coolest thing ever. It isn't as cool looking back thanks to films like Infinity War, but it's still great. Loki is great and the Battle of New York was phenomenal. My main issue is with the middle of the film, as it just felt like Steve and Tony bickering, and it got a bit annoying in places and wasn't as good as in Civil War. 8 out of 10. Number 49, Avengers Age of Ultron. I feel slightly more invested with the plot for this film, and I think the pacing is better. However, the comedy really lets the film down, as it's really inappropriate in a lot of scenes, and kind of messes with the tone, and I can see why that throws some people off. This and the first Avengers are practically neck and neck for me. 8 out of 10. Number 48, Outbreak. I'm a bit ashamed to say that I watched this film ironically, as I watched it during the January lockdown. This film is genuinely great, but watching it during a pandemic makes it unintentionally funny. I'm a horrible person. 8 out of 10. Number 47, Klaus. Aside from the predictable and tedious Leia reveal plotline, this movie is really funny, creative, and a heartwarming Christmas film with a wonderful animation style. You should definitely check it out, as it came out in 2009 and is already a firm Christmas classic. 9 out of 10. Number 46, Paranorman. Whilst not my absolute favourite Leica movie, we'll get to that later, this movie is still fantastic. Not only is it really funny in places, especially with Mitch and Alvin, but it also tells a brilliant yet really dark story with great twists and turns and a great atmosphere. A Halloween classic to be sure. 9 out of 10. Number 45, Rare Exports. Probably the single most underrated Christmas film, as not enough people talk about it. This film is definitely weird, yet I love it for it. It subverts the traditional Christmas tropes in favour of a really unique story, which is still really fun to watch. I best describe it as a movie-length Inside Number 9 episode, but without Pemberton and Shearsmith. I say that because it's a really dark story, but still has some fun moments. 9 out of 10. Number 44, The Exorcist. The single scariest movie I have ever seen. It works really well and was very effective on me, however, I am never watching the film again, so I guess it's a double-edged sword. Still, really well made though. 9 out of 10. Number 43, Jumanji Welcome to the Jungle. Honestly, much better than the original film. The original film had a bit of a tone problem in my opinion, but this is a fun film through and through and I love it. The Rock is as great as ever and Jablinski cracks me up as he's having to play a popular girl in a man's body. Also, as a Doctor Who fan, I love Karen Gillan. 9 out of 10. Number 42, Guardians of the Galaxy. A really fun Marvel film with fantastic songs to sing along to. All of the cast are memorable and play off each other so well, with Rocket being my favourite. However, there are also some great emotional moments. A really fun film which I feel like outsiders to the MCU could easily enjoy. 9 out of 10. Number 41, The Polar Express. This film has a ton of flaws and the plot doesn't really make much sense. However, I can't bring myself to rate it any lower, as this was a childhood favourite of mine, and still is a Christmas tradition. I have watched it every year for the past decade or so I'm just too attached to it. Even then, the animation isn't as bad as people say for the humans, but the train and the landscapes look fantastic. The music is incredible, and Tom Hanks deserves some praise for doing motion capture for 5 main characters. 9 out of 10. Number 40, The Amazing Spider-Man. Yes, I prefer this film to the original Spider-Man. I really do not have the time in this segment to justify that, as it really deserves its own video, but in short, the film is really enjoyable, and the more serious tone works for this kind of film. Gwen is so much better than MJ, and Andrew Garfield is great, even if looks-wise he doesn't fit Peter Parker. The main issue is that this film came out too soon after the Raimi trilogy. 9 out of 10. Number 39, Muppet's Christmas Carol. The best adaptation of A Christmas Carol, and this is coming from someone who is having to analyse every detail of the book for English in school. So, I kinda hate the story now. Michael Caine is great as Scrooge, when he's not singing, and I honestly got emotional over a talking frog. It's just really effective and well done, and a great introduction to the original story for younger kids. 9 out of 10. Number 38, Shrek 2. Just as funny as the original with an even better message and one of the best climaxes in film. It's Shrek 2, man. Do I need to explain any further? 9 out of 10. Number 37, Monty Python and the Holy Grail. A comedy classic to be sure with some amazing jokes and quotable lines. There are a lot of different sketches in the story, and I'd say that some don't really work, and a few have dated a bit, but the rest are phenomenal. I also just love the ending. 9 out of 10.
I guess I'll use this moment to tell you all to subscribe to the channel and like the video. Right, back to the list.
Number 36, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Even better than the original. There are still some really funny moments, and the intro with Mr. Blue Sky is one of the best openings to any film. Although maybe it's just because I love the song. There are also some fantastic emotional moments which I dare not spoil. Check it out if you loved the first. 9 out of 10. Number 35, Spider-Man Homecoming. I know some people don't like this film because of how reliant Peter is on Tony, but I personally don't mind it, as it shows he's still learning due to being a lot younger. Also, he does end up beating the villain without the Tony suit in the end, so I personally think it works. Also, I still stand Ned and MJ, although less MJ in this film, which she doesn't do much. And Michael Keaton as the Vulture is phenomenal. 9 out of 10. Number 34, Iron Man. I can't think of a better way to start off the MCU than with this. RDJ is incredibly charismatic as Tony, and the pacing is really good as well. I do love Jeff Bridges, but he isn't the greatest villain ever, and Rhodey with a different actor does throw me off. Still, a very, very good way to start off this franchise, as well as a great way to introduce the character of Tony Stark. 9 out of 10. Number 33, Monsters, Inc. Quite possibly the funniest Pixar film, as well as the most creative one. I love the concept of this so much, and the villains are great. The animation also looks great for 2001, and the music is so catchy. A really fun time for the family. 9 out of 10. Number 32, A Very Harold and Kumar Christmas. Okay, this film is a very lowbrow comedy which a lot of people won't like, however, I absolutely adore this movie. It consistently gets a laugh out of me, and watching it in 3D just enhances the experience, and there's a lot of great meta jokes about it. I also really like the editing in places, as it's very unique. If you like this kind of humour, then check it out. 9 out of 10. Number 31, Home Alone. The family are dicks and the plot makes little sense. Apart from that, I adore this movie. It's a Christmas classic for many people for a reason, due to the funny as hell slapstick and the Christmas heart it has. The church scene is really well done. I just love it. 9 out of 10. Number 30, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. Another John Hughes film and another great one. This is just a fun ride throughout. Steve Martin and John Candy play off each other so well, and the scenarios they're in are all funny despite how over the top they are. If you're a fan of other John Hughes films like Home Alone, then I recommend this. 9 out of 10. Number 29, Home Alone 2 Lost in New York. Exactly the same as the original film with the same problems, however, even funnier. Mostly thanks to Tim Curry. 9 out of 10. Number 28, Elf. Another nostalgic Christmas film for me, but with less problems than The Polar Express. Not every joke works, but there are still a ton that I love, and Will Ferrell's performance is just so fun to watch. It's just a fun time all around with a great climax. 9 out of 10. Number 27, Captain America the First Avenger. One of the most underrated movies ever. Everyone always sees it as the mediocre Captain America movie, but whilst it is the weakest, it is still fantastic. I love Steve as a character, and I love what he stands for. Peggy is a lot of fun, and the villain is actually quite intimidating. Don't overlook this. We'll definitely do a video on this to give it the recognition it deserves. 9 out of 10. Number 26, Paddington. Funny, charming, phenomenal CGI, made with love for the books, endlessly rewatchable, and such a fun time. I could keep going. This movie is amazing. 9 out of 10. Number 25, Spider-Man 2. With the exception of MJ and a few dumb moments, this movie is truly phenomenal. The comedy works a lot better here than in the other Raimi films, but there are also some great emotional moments. There are some fantastic scenes, like the train stopping one for instance, and I love how Peter has to look after his mental health to get his powers back after he loses them. Well, that part wasn't explicitly said, but it was heavily implied. 9 out of 10. Number 24, Captain America Civil War. A really weak villain means I can't rate this any higher, which is a shame as the film is phenomenal. I love how this works as an aftermath to Age of Ultron, as well as other MCU movies, and gives the characters and the audience an interesting dilemma about the job as a hero. The airport scene is phenomenal, and the ending is beautifully well done and kind of haunting. 9 out of 10. Number 23, Avengers Endgame. I have some minor flaws with the film, which I won't say as these are meant to be spoiler free, but apart from that, it is a fantastic end to the MCU. The entire third act is just perfection, but I also still love the first two acts. Satisfying is the best word to describe it. 9 out of 10. Number 22, Thor Ragnarok. The film which turned Thor from the least popular Avenger to one of the most popular. This film tried to be a comedy and it succeeds with flying colours. Thor is really fun to watch in this and Loki is still great. A lot of the film is improvised and it really shows the cast look like they're having such a blast. However, when the story needs to be serious, it really is and it works so well. The use of the Immigrant Song is also appreciated. I stand corked, by the way, 9 out of 10. Number 21, Ghostbusters. Used to be one of my top 3 favourite movies. On rewatch, I didn't enjoy it nearly as much. However, it is still such a fun ride with an incredibly likable group for our leads. The library, hotel, and ending scenes are all just perfect. My only problem was that it was a lot more sexual than I remembered, but that's most likely a problem with just me. Also, the music is amazing, 9 out of 10. Number 20, GoldenEye. The only Bond film I watched this year, and it was truly fantastic. Brosnan is great in the role, despite this being his first film, and there are so many awesome scenes, especially the tank one. The title theme is also great, 9 out of 10. Number 19, The Stand. I know this is a mini-series, but I like to treat it as one movie, as it is an adaptation of just one book. Anyway, there are a few cheesy moments like with most King adaptations, however, I really just love the atmosphere of the story. The characters are also really memorable to the point that you really do care for them. This was another film I watched in lockdown, but unlike Outbreak, I got a lot more emotion out of it, 9 out of 10. Number 18, Jaws. A true Spielberg masterpiece, one of the best examples for how to build tension in the scene. The film stars 3 fantastic characters who play off each other really well, but they also add a lot to their scenes due to their fears, as well as great lines like,
"You're gonna need a bigger boat."
My only issues are the fact that the mayor is really frustrating, and I also find the bit of the film before the 3 sail away on the Orca and after the infamous jump scare to be a bit slow. I just want them to get on the boat already. Other than that, it's fantastic. 9 out of 10.
Bruh, look at this dude.
That was the last 9 out of 10 film. These next films are all 10 out of 10s in my opinion. So that means I will start to spend a little bit longer on each placement because I love them all so much. This also means that I have to start ranking the films based off of nitpicks, so be prepared. Number 17, After Christmas. My absolute favourite Christmas movie and easily the second most underrated one behind Rare Exports. No one outside of the UK seems to talk about it, and that's annoying as it truly is fantastic. Not only is it really funny with a lot of Christmas heart to it, but it also has a great message about whether the old ways are better or whether we should move on with technology. I definitely need to do a video on this as it is such a clever Christmas film, which you should definitely check out when the season comes again. 10 out of 10. Number 16, Captain America The Winter Soldier. The best non-Avengers movie in the MCU. I love how we see Steve struggle with adjusting to the modern world and how distraught he is to find out who the Winter Soldier is. This is also Nick Fury's best appearance and I just love the whole undercover espionage story. The elevator scene is also an absolute masterpiece of a scene and the ending is amazing. Absolutely incredible, 10 out of 10. Number 15, Coraline. This is my favourite Laika movie and one of my favourite animated movies ever. Not only is the animation beautiful, but the story is brought to life so well because of it, and really makes the world from Neil Gaiman's twisted mind come to life. Fantastic voice acting from everyone with some genuinely creepy moments. The story as a whole is also left a bit open-ended, which paves the way for fan theories to be created, and I love that they did that. The only issue is one scene which was a bit cringy. 10 out of 10. Number 14, Paddington 2. Somehow better than the original. I haven't seen Citizen Kane, but I agree that this is better. It's Paddington 2. Enough said. 10 out of 10. Number 13, Spider-Man No Way Home. I did a full spoiler review for this film on my channel, so I recommend checking that out, as I don't really want to repeat myself here, but for some brief spoiler-free thoughts, I thought this was fantastic and completed a character arc for Tom Holland's Spider-Man perfectly. My second favourite Spider-Man movie. 10 out of 10. Wait a minute, I just said that The Winter Soldier was my favourite non-Avengers movie, and then No Way Home came through. Well, that's an error on my part, but I ain't re-recording. Number 12, Die Hard.
Die Hard!
This movie is a Christmas movie. Anyway, this film is absolutely fantastic and one of the best action films. Unlike a lot of other action films, Die Hard features a really likable and charismatic protagonist who still goes through hell, so that makes him more relatable. Hans Gruber is also a phenomenal villain and the film is just filled with one-liners. I'd love to place it higher, but the incompetent police is the only issue. Still great though. Not my favourite Christmas movie, as that's after Christmas, but a better movie. 10 out of 10. Number 11, Avengers Infinity War. The best Avengers movie. This movie truly felt like an event, with so many characters having to work together for the same goal. However, everyone truly felt like they had the amount of screen time that they deserve, and it's always awesome to watch. Also, that ending still gets me. A worthy semi-finale to the MCU. 10 out of 10. Number 10, Spurlues, also known as The Vanishing. The best foreign language film I have ever seen. Truly haunting, yet real. Stanley Kubrick actually called this the scariest movie he had ever seen. I would love to say more, but I don't want to risk spoilers, as you have to go into this movie without knowing the ending. To prevent spoilers, I will say now that if you want to watch the film, it's on YouTube Movies, Apple TV, and Amazon Prime. Don't look up anything about the film as there could be spoilers. 10 out of 10. Number 9, Zootopia. Honestly, my favourite Disney movie. Not only is it a really fun and captivating detective story with two great leads who play off each other really well, it's also got a great message about racism. There are some scenes which are genuinely hard to watch, like Nick's backstory, and I personally just think it was handled well. Whether you think it was handled well is up to you, but you can't deny that the intention was good. I don't even mind the villain much, but it's definitely the weakest part. Also, this kids' film referenced The Godfather and Breaking Bad. What? 10 out of 10. Number 8, The Blues Brothers. I can see why this was a college classic for my parents, as it was absolutely hysterical, with some of the best car chases in film, even better than most Bond films. The songs are all so, so catchy, and the film is just a good time all around, which I could watch any day. It is a bit silly in how over the top it is, but that's the kind of humor I love. Definitely check it out. 10 out of 10.
Would there be anything else?
Yes, do you have a Miss Piggy?
Number 7, Back to the Future 3. Easily the weakest Back to the Future film, but that's only because it has the one part of the trilogy I don't like, which is the forced misunderstanding plot between Doc and Clara. Aside from that, the film and the trilogy is essentially perfect. I love the Western aesthetic, and I also love how this film feels like it has slightly lower stakes than the previous one, so it lets the audience calm down if they binge through all three. The ending train scene is absolute perfection. That's just a fantastic way to end the trilogy. 10 out of 10. Number 6, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse.
We don't really talk about this.
This movie is a masterpiece. For real this time. Everything about the film is amazing. The animation is beautiful. The music complements Miles as a character as well as the scenes perfectly. I buy all of Miles' struggles at school and with his relationship with his dad. The film is really funny and still makes me laugh out loud, and the message is just brilliant. Please, go and watch this film. I need to do a video on this. Easily the best Marvel film and one of the best superhero movies. 10 out of 10. Number 5, Donnie Darko. Those who know me personally will know that I haven't shut up about this film since I saw it in July, but that's purely because it has had such an impact on me. I love every frame of this movie. It may be confusing, but I honestly don't care as I love the film anyway. It's the same way I treat The Shining. I love it no matter how confusing it is. You will have to be in the right mindset when watching it, but otherwise, it is absolutely fantastic. This is the priority film I need to do a full video on, as there is just too much to talk about. 10 out of 10. Number 4, Toy Story 2. My favourite Pixar film, and also my favourite animated film. Although I haven't rewatched The Incredibles in a little while. This film has two different main plots, and they are both equally great for different reasons, and work together so well in the film. Buzz's story is super fun, and I laugh out loud at many scenes even today. However, Woody's story is really intriguing and poses far more interesting questions than the first Toy Story movie, all about what happens when a kid grows up, which is then followed through on in the third movie. This is such a good sequel. It is a lot slower paced, but it works so well, and the contrast with Buzz's story is even better. Truly incredible. 10 out of 10. By the way, I was going to watch the other Toy Story films, but couldn't be asked to, so... Number 3, Jurassic Park. My second favourite film ever made. You'll understand why it's in third in a bit. This is an absolute masterclass in how to build tension. The first half of the film is very slow paced, but it works really well as it lets you get to know all of our characters, as well as establish location and foreshadow later events. It still builds tension though, as we see the different layers which lead to the power going out. The second half of the film is just constant action and tension, but it's not non-stop as there are slower moments to let the audience catch their breath. If you haven't seen this film, go and do so and come back with the theme stuck in your head. 10 out of 10. Number 2, Back to the Future 2. I can't explain my reasonings for this one without saying, number 1, Back to the Future. Yeah, these two kind of go hand in hand, as they are neck and neck for me. The reason I call Jurassic Park my second favourite film is because I put the whole Back to the Future trilogy in my number 1. I should definitely do a full video on why this is my favourite trilogy, but otherwise, these two films are both absolutely equally incredible. It was tough to decide which was better, but I went with the first film for now simply because it has more iconic scenes in the second. These two have always been my favourite films, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. I rewatch it every year, so expect to see it at the top again next year. Both movies are obviously a 10 out of 10. Whew! So that was my ranking of every film I watched in 2021. I will definitely do this again this year, as I had a ton of fun making this one. Be sure to let me know what your favourite and least favourite film you saw last year was. No need to do a full rating. And yeah, I'll try and respond to as many of you as possible. Anyway, I'll see you next time.